Hello. This will be the first time writing this story down and likely the last as well, as I have moved on, hopefully. Now that the place I was working at has finally and due to reasonable concerns closed down. I usually spend my time over at TG but feel like, not only might there be interest here on X but maybe also a reassuring word on how I handled the situation. There are no IDs on this board so I will trip with Hyacinth. Because he is a great character in Greek mythology, and that is X enough I hope. I'll start now. Yeah? I am a 24-year-old male kindergarten teacher and nurse. Yes, OP is a fag for real this time, and the following account happened in the time frame from February 2011 to January 2012. I am not a great writer, but I hope you will get that this happened over a year and as terrible as it wasn't like a 90-minute horror movie. But I will try to explain it all in detail. In February 2011 I moved to a new state after working as an early years educator for about 2 years but fell in love with someone and relocated. I found a new job that combined what I had initially learned, nursing, with my passion for working with kids. I was hired as a caretaker in a psychiatric hospital for kids and teens. It's by far not as spooky as it sounds. It's on one hand sad and on the other hand very tense. Because a lot of the kids are in there for aggression management or PTSD-related behavioral patterns, but also various types of depression. In the time I worked there, there were no psychos, and by that I mean no one was straight up nuts. Just troubled creatures. Sad as that is. I have to say straight up that the place was shit. Mismanaged. Highly unorganized and overall not good on the doctor's side. On the nursing side, everyone was overworked and later on accusations against about patient abuse. Though I haven't witnessed any may have been likely, not because people working there were evil, but handling patients on their very limit constantly due to misguided leadership and organization. I worked way too much as well, but I, even after what happened and loved the job and was happy to get to know a couple of extremely intelligent, creative, and sensitive kids, as often the case W. Unstable souls. I did night shifts every other week. While in the weeks I worked during daytime, I was quintessentially a playing board games, music, crafts. You get the gist. Great stuff, as I believe certain games can help dealing with stress, while others can give you back concentration, or even self-esteem. There were two patients I spend a lot of time with and who I will call Andy and Laura, who were in the hospital during the entire time of this written account. Andy was 9, both parents died early in his childhood, superhero potential, who was in hospital because of dissociative episodes and severe depression. Laura was a 13-year-old Aspie, who suffered from PTSD and severe nyctophobia after getting lost in the woods, and recovered a week later. There were plenty of other kids obviously, but these two have a place in my heart. The hospital itself is closed down now. Must have been there for at least 60 years. And some of the games you could still find are proof of that. Cell phones and so on are forbidden were patients, so everyone had to make do with Monopoly and whatnot. I would say February was fun actually, a thrill, a new job, living with my boyfriend. It was great. In mid-March things started to get very different. The hospital was being rightfully blamed by many. The people working, started to hate it there even more. And the kids got wilder and sadder because they obviously picked up on it. I went to great lengths to make it better, bought new games from my own, cleaned up the toy storage, found a few cool things but threw out a lot of crap and broken things. Basically ending up with a couple of board games and glitter. Making room for toy cars and a playhouse and new card games. The kids loved it and I loved playing certain games thinking, Risk is good for focus, Jenga for nerves, Uno is social etc. I had the first dream the day after I did the spring cleaning. In the dream everything was a weird version of my apartment and me and my partner had adopted Andy. And I woke up in the dream because I heard a glass or candle falling over on our glass couch table. Andy slept in the middle. I looked to see if he had woken up, but he slept and so I went into the living room. What I saw was so unsettling that I woke up right away with the picture burned into my mind. It was such a strong image. A boy of maybe 7 years old with white skin and very dark shadows around his eyes. He was naked, except for white socks. He was seemingly flowing mid-air in a bathrobe that was 3 times too big. The bathrobe seemed cramped though with even the pockets bulging. It was so disturbingly strange. No other way to say so. I was left with a weird feeling of guilt or maybe caution. Bathrobe boy kept appearing in my dreams. Without it getting any different from the first time. I dreamt of him at least twice a week. Maybe a month later when I did a night shift, I saw Andy suffering from sleep paralysis. It was terrible and I could barely wake him up. He felt strangled. As it appears to happen frequently, Wikipedia tells me that. He said that a boy tried to kill him. It hurt me to see him get worse. You see, I am not freaking out. Things like this are, well, normal in an environment like this, so it took too long for me to realize that something wasn't right. This is what haunts me most, that I could have opened my eyes earlier and prevent pain. But I didn't see it. For a long time. Throughout April and May, both Andy and Laura appeared to not make any progress but instead get worse and both had nightly terrors, some I was there for. Some unfortunately not. In late May Laura suffered from SP every night, so much we had to put her on medication to ensure she got enough sleep. Sleep is really important to ensure balanced hormonal levels and lessen depression, which seemed to get worse for Laura by the day. She slept then. And up until August. Even though everything in the hospital started to get messed up, it was a normal day-to-day kind of vibe. Until August 16th. I played some Jenga with Andy and Laura, before they went to bed, stopping after one round because it just too hyper, you know. Not the game to play before you sleep. Then ate something real quick and then started to read some Beckett. I love that dude. Around 4 a.m. I took a walk through the rooms and, luckily, saw Laura. She was sleeping, but after 10 seconds I realized she couldn't breathe. I turned on the light only to find she was blue basically. In absolute panic. I checked and went for CPR. Thinking she might have respiratory problems because of the meds. She didn't respond to it and after about a minute I picked her up calling a standby doctor. It was in the moment I had her in my arms. That she took a breath, and woke up. She started to cry and so did I. The doctor arrived. And checked her out, asking me to fetch her details to see how much medicine she was given etc. As I walked down the hall and turned to the door, I saw him. I saw the reflection of the boy in the bathrobe. Floating, but for the first time he had open eyes, he was looking at me. I freaked out and screamed. I clearly was overly tired. Night shifts fuck with you. Especially when they are as fucking intense to begin with. My screaming woke up at least three kids. I was a bit overwhelmed by it all and started to cry. I was excused, and asked to take a week off the next day. After being lectured that I should not invest this much feeling into certain kids. And although painful, it was true. I really cared for these two. I came back after a week of chilling with my boyfriend, who was worried sick as well. Especially after I told him about these recurring dreams. I tried to keep my distance from A and L. Though I couldn't ignore them either. Because it would have hurt them. Before I finished work, Andy came up to me, gave me a hug and said the strangest thing. I was really confused and wanted to know what he meant, but he stopped there and didn't want to talk anymore. These words lingered with me till November. Even though everything normalized itself and we all were back to normal. Normal, well, as normal as it gets in an environment of that kind. Sometime in November. The 18th to be precise, it was Andy's birthday. I made him cookies and we all had cake and played all sorts of games. I finished work at 6, but puppy eyes made me stay till 7 to play a game of Twister, as referee, and Jenga. Which I intentionally lost for one to make Andy happy. But also to call it a day. I said goodbye, met up with my boyfriend for a pastrami sandwich and fell into bed at 1. The next thing that happened was without a doubt the thing that scared and scarred me most in my life. I woke up and within a second I realized I could not move. I couldn't even move my head. But I felt something was there. As fast as a bolt of lightning, something went straight for me. I felt a something wrap around my neck and tighten. And then I saw his face. The floating boy 2 inches away from my face, dark eyes looking at me. With hate, full of blame. I couldn't scream, I couldn't breathe. He came closer and whispered, "Stop." Suddenly his face replaced by my boyfriend's, shaking me. I could breathe. I could move. I couldn't sleep. I was shaking for the rest of the night. Unable to speak. I took Saturday off to have 2 days of recovery and return on Monday. All I wanted to do was to tell the two children this. This was ridiculous. What? Why? So this was me, an adult, wanting to tell a secret to two kids. I waited till lunch and made sure to sit with the two of them. I just said it. Like it happened. The boy with the belt came to me at night. Both kids were unfazed. Andy said to me, "You are a loser, Anon. Have you ever been insulted by a kid? It strangely hurts." Laura kept to herself. When I asked her who he was, and why he tried to strangle me, I felt absolutely crazy. I can't put it into words. I was on the verge of madness. When I cleaned up the table, Laura came up to me and said, "I will tell you later." "Okay." I thought, with cold sweat above my lip. But she didn't. She played by herself. Not wanting company. I left work on time, and went home. Made dinner and got ready for bed. I took my book from my bag to read something. Inside I found a drawing that disturbed me and probably will do so for the rest of my life. This picture that I found inside was most likely Laura's. It depicted a young boy in a large coat hanging down from the ceiling. He had on a sad expression with tears running down his face. It was even more horrific, considering it was made by a child. If the Jenga towers falls, he gets strangled. When you lose, you kill him. I lost the other night. He sought out revenge. I have heard about messed up stuff that happened there in the past, but this fucked up? Kids killing kids in a way so sadistic?